Thank the organizers. The talks have been really very, very interesting. And so the topic we'll discuss today comes from the study of a very specific problem we were interested in, and which I think hides some interesting mathematical aspects, and therefore I think it's appropriate for this workshop. And so this, what I will be talking about is some work that we have been doing in our group in Turing, and I should mention Carlo Baldassi, Federica Gerace, Alessandro Ingrosso, Carlo Lucibello, and Luca Saglietti. There are three PhD students, a postdoc, and a colleague of mine, Baldassi, who had a great part in this work. And then there are some other ongoing projects with Christian Borg and Jennifer Chase in Boston. So essentially, the type of problem we want to discuss is try to understand what we have learned about random constraint satisfaction problems can help us in understanding issues in learning. And in particular, we will see that treating learning problems as constraint satisfaction problems will open some new perspective and allow us to understand why and how certain type of network, neural network, work. And this will lead to some new results, and hopefully to some new algorithm based on a new measure for analyzing solution in the case of random instances of learning problems. So just in a very philosophical sense, what we wanted to do at the beginning was try to put together our understanding of consensus satisfaction problem and of learning problems. But then what happened that, in fact, by doing this, we discovered some new geometrical structure that somehow escaped from our analysis. So this is a nice example in which actually the replica method is not sufficient to understand what happens in the learning problem, because what is relevant from an algorithmic point of view is hidden in the tail of the Gibbs distribution. So, and it has to be somehow revealed by a large deviation analysis, which is not captured by the standard replica symmetry breaking scheme, at least. So just a little bit of review. So Spengler's theory has been used to study learning problems since the 80s, and there were some very important results in the 80s, the analysis of attractor neural networks, memorizing random patterns, or the study of the computational performance of feed-forward networks, and so how many random patterns you can actually store with the neural networks and with one or multiple layers, and so on. And I should mention that in that period, many of the things that we have been discussing recently about random optimization problem were already observed in the case of formal neural networks. For instance, the fact that the space of solution is decomposed into many domains, some of them have carried the dominant Gibbs weight and some other are subdominant, and so on. All these things were already known in the case of neural networks storing random patterns. So there are a lot of things that we did knew about. But of course, the problem was that at that time, we were just using essentially the replica method, so no algorithms. So somehow, the interest in this kind of study faded away. So somehow, there was a peak of interest in the 80s. And then the community stopped working on this type of topic. But of course, in the last years, there's been a lot of activity in the field of artificial neural network. This is due to deep learning, so to the fact that GPUs became available, a lot of data, and so on and so forth. A lot of biological data, which one can use to model systems. And so now we are back, and we think this is the appropriate time to try to treat again this kind of problem and try to understand more from the algorithmic point of view what's happening in this system. And I should, as we know, in the case of deep learning, the performance are kind of interesting. However, there's a lack of understanding from a mathematical point of view, and also there are some clear computational bottlenecks that are emerging. For instance, already now the deep networks are just using few bits of precision because they need to run fast, otherwise they cannot cope with the amount of data they have to deal with. So somehow, even at the hardware level, there are some problems emerging, even though theoretical understanding is not even it's very limited. So some notation. So I will consider the problem of storing some patterns that I call Xi mu, and in particular we consider the case in which these patterns are binary, but this is not necessary. And has the parameters of the models are called Ws. These are the so-called weights of the neural network. I guess you are most of you have seen what these kind of models are, and I will show it in a minute. So essentially, the idea is that you give to, this is the architecture on the edges here. You have some weights, and these nodes compute a nonlinear function of the sum of the incoming signals that are weighted by the weight. So you see here you have psi entering here. You reweight the psi j with the wjk. And so you have an input signal arriving here. This neuron makes a nonlinear transformation. In this case, it's a step function and produces an output. And this output is projected to another neuron and so on. And so and you can generalize this to very complicated architecture, but the scheme is this one. And the idea is that you want to find the set of Ws such that a given set of input is labeled in the right way. You want to implement an input-output mapping, which is correct, on a given training set. Now, if you think to this problem in terms of a factor graph, this is has this form. So now your independent variable will be the weights over the edges. And so I represent them with circles. And each pattern, so each input-output relation corresponds to a constraint that the W have to satisfy. So the factor graph you will have to deal with would be a fully connected graph with the number of factor nodes, which is equal to the number of patterns that you want to satisfy. Okay, so this is just you know, like a k-sat problem where instead of having, you know, k input links in the factor graph, you have order n input links, and the factor node, the function which is implemented by this factor node depends on the architecture of your network. In the case in which you have, you know, just one output for an architecture like this, essentially what you're trying to do is to divide your inputs in two sets. But of course, this can be generalized to much more complicated objectives. So the problem you want to study is, you know, I want to see which are the performance of objects like this in the case in which the Ws are constrained to be very, very simple. So low precision synapses, weights, I call the weights synapses. So essentially, I consider the case in which the weights are bits, just plus or minus one. Okay? So I want to know what happens if I try to learn with binary neural networks. And there are some, so as I said, we were interested in the problem. So there are some biological reasons why we're interested in this problem. So this is a beautiful picture. I don't know if the resolution allows to see of a synapse. You can see the vesicles, which allow charges to go through the synapse. Anyhow, there are some experiments showing that you know, synaptic potentiation is a kind of a unitary event. It's not a very precise graded process, but it's a rather a step function like this, in the sense that if you stimulate the synapse, this undergoes a potentiation, and then so it's a kind of a noisy switch. That's more or less the idea. And so, and also from a modeling point of view, I really like to believe that, you know, you have 10 to the 15 synapses and you want to have a model that, you know, doesn't rely too much on the precision. And also, as I mentioned before, even for technological purposes, you have to deal with the fact that you must have limited precision connection in your hardware. Otherwise, it is too time-consuming and too heavy for the hardware to run the... And there's some recent work that shows that, you know, in general, I mean, some experimental work showing that in any case, and whether the synapses are binary or not is, you know, it's not it's not clear. However, synapses have a limited precision, few bits. So this is done by measuring some with high resolution the synaptic contact. But anyhow, so I don't want to enter, just to say that I do want to give some motivation, because these are the true motivation for us as a group of physicists to study this problem. So the problem I'm going to study now is the following. I'm going to take the simplest possible neural network, which is the building block of deep network, so the single perceptron. So I just have one layer and one output. This is, and I have the weights here. I will assume that the weights are binary. And the output is given by a nonlinear function, in this case that's just the sine, of the sum of the wi times the input. So this is the nonlinear transformation. And what we want to do is to find the w's, which are binary, such that a certain set of input-output association are implemented by the machine. And so essentially this is again the same photograph as I've shown you before. And here I consider the regime in which the patterns are random, so they are just plus or minus one with equal probability. And the interesting regime is the case in which you try to store order n patterns with this machine. So it's just like random KSAT where you have, yeah?
Do you assume anything about the input at all, some kind of distribution or anything?
I take just a flat distribution, just plus or minus one is probably one half, but this is not, I mean, it has to be factorized, but you could consider biased things. Okay, so this problem was studied in 1989 by Kraut and Mezard and by Gardner and Derrida even before. So there are a lot of paper. And so the phase diagram is very similar to KSAT. So there's a critical, actually it's harder than KSAT. So there's a critical alpha above which you cannot satisfy the constraints, so you cannot store the patterns. And it's very interesting because in this region here, you have even what is called freezing. So from a statistical physics point of view, as you lower the temperature here, the system freezes completely at finite temperature. So it's like a random energy model. So it's a particularly hard problem here. And in this region here, you have a certain entropy, which means you have a certain number of solution, which goes to zero as you approach the critical capacity. Okay, and so this was the scenario, and what it was known also that the solution were isolated. So the dominant solution for this kind of random constraint satisfaction problem are kind of isolated clusters. So each solution is order n far away from another solution. They're point-like solutions. So it's like an error-correcting code. Okay, so completely different from random KSAT. You don't have the unfrozen variable you can play with, or you don't have. That was the scenario, and so what you would expect is just it's very hard to find a solution. So, and in fact, heuristic algorithms were believed not to work for this kind of problem. And so, more or less, the situation is just to make a comparison with KSAT is that in case of KSAT, you have this kind of phase diagram has the number of constraints over the number of values increase, so you have a connected cluster of solution which breaks into many components and so on and so forth until they disappear. And there's a region in which it's hard for a Monte Carlo algorithm to find solution because of the glassy states. And so there's a 1 RSB region which is hard. But in the case of the perceptron problem, which binary perceptron problem, which is more or less the same, just fully connected, what you have is you just have kind of isolated solution, that's all, apparently. Okay, and of course, so the problem is apparently hard for any alpha, and so one could wonder whether learning is at all possible with these kind of problems. So if you have a simple model of a neuron for which learning is kind of impossible, it starts to be annoying. And if you just run simulated annealing on this problem, and this is just small simulation, you clearly see that it gets stuck. I mean, this is for a small size. Yeah?
So just in terms of modeling, why do you want to associate two arbitrary patterns, arbitrary plus and minus one? Do you think that that's something that happens in real problems?
No, real problem can be easier. Right. You're right. This is kind of a hard case, but you might have to. So, yeah. So the question we wanted to address is whether it's actually learning impossible in these kind of systems. So what's going on in this constraint satisfaction problem, which is strange. So recently, Kabashim and Huang and other people started to study the actual distance between typical solutions. So what they use is the so-called Franz-Parisi potential method, in which essentially they take sampling from dominant solution and compute the distance between solution. So you have to, you know, compute this quantity by the replica method, and they were able, they just computed which is the minimum distance between dominant solution as a function of alpha. And what they found is a curve like this, which shows that for any value of alpha, so even for very few patterns, dominant solution are far apart. Okay? So which means that the landscape you should think of for this problem is a landscape in which you have solution which are far apart, order n, I mean distance, and then you have a lot of local minima above which trap the Monte Carlo algorithm or any type of algorithm that wants to minimize this energy. Okay? So, and this is, it's a complicated but standard replica calculation that can be done. And so the question is, this is the replica prediction. By the way, this replica prediction, the original work, Bernard Kraut and Mark Mezar studied this problem up to two levels of replica symmetry breaking, and you know, they were not able to find any other solution except the one that I've been describing. So unless there are some very complicated numerical issues, the main message is that even if you use the one RSV scheme and you look for say subdominant contribution, as it would happen in the case of KSAT. I mean, you have shown this picture which depends on lambda, you know, in which you compute the complexity versus the entropy, and then you find those which dominate the Gibbs measure. Okay, I'm referring to the talks of yesterday by Alan and Nike. Then, if you do the same thing here, you find nothing. You just find one point. Okay, you don't find the whole curve. Just one point. Yeah.
If you have a low collection capabilities and you always have a distance over the
solution. Yeah.
So any memory device will have the same problems.
Yeah, but let me, because the conclusion I want to reach is actually the opposite of that. So let me. So this was the. So essentially, the question is, you know, is the landscape a golf course and is learning impossible? Well, there's some numerical evidence. You know, with Alfredo Branstad some few years ago, we just, you know, applied belief propagation with reinforcement, so-called it's a smooth decimation procedure based on belief propagation, and we were able to actually solve this problem up very close to the critical capacity. So you see, so you have a kind of a paradox. On the one hand, you have this landscape which is made of isolated solution. On the other hand, you have an algorithm which is very simple that works. Not only that algorithm works, but even very, very simple versions. You take the spend much time on this, but you take this BP equation, you try to simplify them. This is a work that we did in collaboration with Nicola Brunel, who is now in Chicago, who sent us a list of five conditions for our algorithm to be biologically plausible. And so we implemented them by, you know, modifying and simplifying the equation. And everything at the end, the algorithm boiled down to a very simple update rule for the weight, which is very, very similar to the so-called perceptron algorithm, just adapted to binary weights. And what we could see is that this extremely simple algorithm indeed works again and doesn't show any finite size effect. Carlo Baldassi considered the case in which instead of storing a fixed set of random patterns, you store patterns that are generated by another network, so you continue to feed your perceptron with new patterns, so you have a stochastic process with independent inputs, and so you can study the evolution equation as a differential equation of this process, and he was able to show that, in fact, it's possible to do learning with a very, very simple algorithm. Okay? So the main question is, you know, is this a finite size effect or what's going on? So that was the. So another thing that one can do is just to take, you know, use one of your favorite algorithms and then use BP to compute what is called the weight enumerator function from the solution that you have found. So compute how many solutions you see at a given distance d from, you know, a reference vector that you have found with some algorithm. And if you do this, what you find is that in fact there's no cut. So the solution that you find are actually not isolated. And if you actually plant a solution by this teacher-student mechanism, you do find that there is a cut. So there's a kind of mystery here. So the solution we found are absent from our phase diagram and still and they appear to be not isolated. And so what we did is that, okay, so we took again this problem, and we decided to look for large deviation properties and to see what was going on. So again, we take the binary perceptron, and and what we decided to do is to actually try to amplify the contribution from regions that contain a high number of solutions. Since the evidence was that, we set up an analytic tool, say, so we defined a new measure for counting solution which gives more weight to dense regions compared to sparse regions. Okay. So we define a new energy function which is not just so the number of errors that the device makes, but is actually the log of the number of satisfying assignments for the Ws within a ball of radius d from a reference configuration. So we define this new this function, which we call the local entropy. So it's the number of solution, it's an exponential number that we assume it's exponential that you find within a certain hypersphere of radius d. And so what we now want to do is to study the property of this objective function. Okay? So we want to see if by analyzing the problem through this measure, which is, you know, completely different from the Gibbs measure, you're actually going to see something different. And you clearly understand that if you use this kind of energy, all the point-like solutions disappear from the scenario because they would have energy, this local entropy equal to zero. Okay? Yeah?
Can you just comment how different is it from the two temperature transparency potential?
Well, the point is that here you're going to optimize this W in order to maximize. So these are not typical. Okay? So you're not sampling from the typical solution of the Gibbs measure, but you're going to optimize at the end with respect to this W. Okay? That's the main. And so, well, I there's a lot of calculations to be done here, but using the replica method. We use the replica method as a method to compute, you know, the average energy for this problem. But this has nothing to do with the replica method used to analyze the problem from the beginning. I mean, the replica method you would use with the standard energy. So it's just a tool that we're using now to study this measure. And okay, I'll skip the details, but you have to introduce a lot of order parameters in order to study this problem. So you have to there's an overlap between different high density reference solution, overlap between solution belonging to the same region. Well, and so on. All possible overlaps between solution and centers within clusters or between different clusters. So this is what comes out from the theory directly. And if you're interested, I can tell you the details of all these calculations. And this is what comes out. So first of all, let's focus on these red lines. And the red lines are telling us the following. So here is the distance. And this is the entropy at a given distance. Okay? Now, the red lines are actually the solution which dominate the Gibbs measure. And you see that as you for a given value of alpha, let's say alpha equal 0.6, as you reduce the distance, this entropy hits zero, which means that there is a gap below which there are no solutions. Okay? This, if you take as a reference, vector, a typical solution. So it's a solution that would dominate the Gibbs measure. Okay? And for a different value of alpha, you would have another curve, but for any value of alpha, you have a gap here, just like in error correcting code. Okay? However, if you now look at the other measure, based on this local entropy, which of course we are going to, what we want to study is actually this function here, and if you take where you raise the power, you raise the number of solutions to a power y, which is equivalent to put a temperature here in front of the energy, and we want to take this artificial temperature to have a large value in order to find clusters that are very, very dense. Okay, and so.
Okay, you're
This is what happens, is that if you use this measure, you actually find that there exist solutions that present no gap. So there exist regions that are extremely dense. And when I say extremely dense, I mean, look at this. You see this, well, you cannot even see. There's a black curve behind this blue curve here. And this is just the binomial coefficient, so it's the total number of configuration within a certain ball of radius d. And you see that for alpha equals, say, 0.4, it's short distance. Essentially, all solution, all configuration around the reference solution are solutions. So somehow you have a lot of points, you know, an exponential number of points, but somewhere you have a region which is extremely, extremely dense. And this is true for any value of alpha. And simply, you know, for a certain distance, the curve just overlaps with essentially the binomial. Of course, there's a tiny difference, but so these are extremely dense regions. And then up to a certain critical value of alpha, where this is true up to a certain critical value of alpha, where this cluster disappears. And so the value of alpha where this cluster disappears is around 0.77. And already, you know, 30 years ago, there was some numerical evidence that you know, algorithm could be working up to that value, and so on. So I found really, I mean, if you think that we started from this problem, and then all of a sudden, we, by doing a different type of analysis, we found that there are, you know, kind of extremely dense regions that, you know, were missed by the replica analysis, that are those that allow algorithm to work efficiently. This is a numerical exhaustive simulation that I find very nice. So let's say that we are here, so we are close to the critical point where this dense cluster disappears. So this is a numerical simulation, an exhaustive simulation. So this is a cluster, alpha is equal to 0.756, and you have 95,000 solutions in this green. And then you add one pattern, and this breaks, and you add another pattern, and then it disappears. So three. So just to say that this disappears with the first order transition. All of a sudden, it's just. And we also analyzed the problem of making prediction with this device. So instead of just taking patterns at random, we consider the case in which we take patterns generated by another network so that we can ask the question, are we able to learn a rule with this kind of device? And it's very interesting because for this kind of simple model, you can actually compute what is the optimal Bayesian prediction you can do, which is this green line. So here you have the number of patterns that the so-called teacher network has provided to the student network. It's called the teacher-student scenario. And this is the generalization error, so the chance that you give the same answer on a pattern that you have never seen before. And this is the Bayesian optimum that you can do. This is the behavior of typical solution, these point-like solutions. And these curves here are those the arrows provided by the solution which belong to this very dense region. So they have the interesting regime is an undersampling regime. So it's here, and you see that they behave quite nicely. So that's and okay. So this was a and also we applied this to some real problem. And this is the very famous, most studied database in computer science. So the hand digit recognition problem, and so on. And you know, with a very simple architecture, essentially just one layer of learning, and then you just have to have 10 outputs. And with this kind of device with binary weights, we could have a prediction error of 1%, which is more or less state of the art for such a simple architecture. And also, what it's possible to show is that if you look now to the solution that the algorithm find, and you do a random walk starting from one of the solutions, you find that indeed all these perceptron here have their weights which belong to a dense region of their weight space. Okay, so learning takes place in these rare, very dense regions. At least this was the numerical evidence. Everything generalizes to multiple states, and we are actually now studying the continuum limit, which we believe also has similar properties, and I can tell you why, but it requires a few minutes, and I don't have probably time. So everything is more or less remains unchanged, and also, well, one can discuss of how many bits is worth having to have good performance, and it turns out that few bits are enough to obtain very high performance. So the question is now, well, what happens when So can we use all this idea to make new algorithms? Well, we have a new measure. We have a new objective function. Okay, and the first thing you want to do is to create a Markov chain that tries to maximize this new objective function. Just forget about detail balance of relative to the original problem. So this is what you would do. You would define an energy function, which is essentially the number of errors that the network makes. And there are some details here because you also would like to use the information of how bad is the prediction, so how bad is the input field, so you can improve your simulated annealing, but it's not relevant. So this would be your energy function, and you can try to do simulated annealing, and you would see that this Markov chain would fail. But now what we can try to do is that, okay, instead of using that objective function, we use this new objective function where we take as an energy the local entropy. And so the question is, how do you compute the local entropy, which is an exponential object? You can use belief propagation to compute this local entropy. And so you can set up a Markov chain in which you make, you flip your reference vector, okay? You evaluate your local entropy, and if this increases, you keep it, otherwise you reject it with a certain probability that depends on the temperature, this artificial temperature that you have used, okay? And so if you do this, it's very nice, because this is what you obtain with the standard simulated annealing. This is a small, just 800 neurons with very small value of alpha. So you have to imagine that if you increase with the size or with alpha, this plateau just goes to infinity. But you clearly see that this is the situation. And if you now use the other Markov chain, this is what you obtain. You just go down straight to the solution. So all these local minima, they are confounding and so on, just disappear. You just go straight to the solution. So I think this is a very, very nice result, because the idea is you have a new measure which allows you to look at the space of solution in a different way, and you can exploit this for algorithmic purposes. And now we are working to some generalization of this. I want to mention a few preliminary results. But the idea is that, this power y, which we have used to tune how much we want the entropy to be high, say, the local entropy to be high, you can take it integer. And this allows to create a lot of new algorithms, which are actually very simple, that do not rely. So this way you can solve the problem of having to use BP to compute the local entropy. So you take y integer. So the objective function you want to maximize, if you take y integer, is just, you remember that you have n to the power y, so you take just n times y times the product, so you have a sum. So essentially what everything boils down to is to have a couple system of y real replicas, which are constrained to be at a given overall distance with respect to a vector that doesn't have to satisfy any particular constraint. So this would be your new objective function, and you can even trace away your reference vector. You can sum over all configuration, and so you'll end up with this cost function, with the objective function. So essentially, you can run your simulated annealing, your Markov chain, directly on this problem with a certain choice of y, which can be 3, 4, 5, or so a finite number. Okay, and it's quite interesting the fact that this energy function depends on the temperature of the original problem. So somehow this is going to smooth the energy landscape. And so there are many technicalities here involved, first of all, you can compute the update efficiently. The Monte Carlo move have to be done in a smart way in order to optimize the rejection rate, because you have to keep the distance relation. So there are many, so it's quite involved, but let's forget about all the details. So at the end, what you have is just the Monte Carlo process that maximize that function. And to give you an example, here we have the case of, we compare the case in which we take just y equals 3, so just 3 replicas, and we compare the case of a standard simulated annealing optimized in the best possible way with respect to this replicated Markov chain. And you see that the replicated Markov chain just goes down to the solution, doesn't suffer any slowing down. So, and I think this is, another interesting application is that, yeah?
It was still exponential.
No. No, no. No. It's just, and actually it's pretty big for neural network. 6,400 is a pretty big system. And a nice thing is that given that you have a replicated system, you can imagine to run BP on the replicated factor graph. Okay, again, now that we accepted the idea that our effective energy function is this set of real replicas that have to be coupled. So a nice thing that comes out is that if you now write the BP equation on this replicated system and you make the simplifying assumption that all the replica give the same signal, so you look at a subspace of the of the solution of fixed point equation, which corresponds to symmetric contribution from all the replicated system, what the message passing equation boiled down to the message passing equation become essentially a variant of BP with reinforcement. So I think we should say the other way around, that BP with reinforcement is a particular case of BP run on this replicated graph. Okay? And so one can choose the parameter. So here you see you have y, and if y is equal to 1, everything disappears because we don't have replicas. But so this is the structure of the equation, which is very similar to the structure you would have with the reinforcement BP. And so if you choose properly the parameters, essentially they behave the same. So finally, we understand what BP with the reinforcement, at least we understand, is doing, in the sense it's actually looking for regions of high local entropy. And this, you know. And then another thing that you can do is of course do just a gradient. Again, we pseudo gradient. We have integer variables. We make them continuous. We take a derivative, and then we go back to discrete. So it's a very dirty way of doing gradient. But anyhow, it's not so crucial. And just the parameters which are important here are this is eta is the learning rate, so the coefficient of the gradient, and this mt is the number of patterns you use to compute the gradient. So if mt equals m equals say m, total number of patterns, then this is called batch gradient. Otherwise, if this is a small subset of patterns, this is called the mini batch. This is just in the language of deep learning, deep networks. Okay, but this is more or less what you would do naively. But now, what you want to do is, in fact, to do the same thing on the replicated Hamiltonian, on the replicated energy function. And again, you can trace away the variables and the reference vector. And if you run this, quite some surprise, at least for me, it's extremely efficient. It's even better than BP with reinforcement. So this is, okay. So this would be the gradient for a certain, so this is a small system with 1,600 weights. This is a committee machine. I forgot to say that all these experiments are done not for a machine which is a bit better than the perceptron. So it's a machine which is, it's a neural network in which you have, so K hidden units, N inputs, and all the hidden units are fully connected. Okay, so, and then all these hidden units give a certain output. So this is the kind of architecture we are considering. And here we have the W's here, and here there are just one. But this is already a pretty complicated object. So for this object here, in which we take K equal 5 and N equal 1,600, just to give you some numerics, you see that the replicated gradient works very, very well, and the standard gradient stops working at, you know, a small volume of alpha, and even where it seems to work, in fact, it takes a lot of time to converge. So which means that if you go to larger n, actually this curve is going to go to zero. Okay, so okay. So now we have been able to do the analytic calculation. We were just in the process of writing up things, and we have been able to do the analytic calculation of the local entropy for these multi-layer architectures, and what comes out is that, in fact, also for these multi-layer architectures, you do have these subspaces which are extremely dense. And so the conjecture is that the reason why...
Do you mean multi-layer or do you mean two-layer? Are you doing really...
No, well, two-layer, this architecture here. The analytic calculation, I don't think you can do more than this, but at least...
That's what I was using.
Yeah, no. But this is very complicated already. I mean, there it took just a lot of days. Carlo is fighting with numerics, but this is nice. Again, you see that you have this overlap with the binomial coefficient. So again, these are extremely dense regions, and so I think that we can somehow reach some conclusion now that is, you know, somehow by using this measure, you can turn our typical properties into typical properties from the computational perspective. You have just to kind of forget about detailed balance. Who cares if you are an algorithm? I mean, you wouldn't care about detailed balance, right? So that's the idea. This can be generalized also to finite temperature. I think there are a lot of physical problems which could be addressed by this kind of analysis, in not necessarily question related to satisfying assignment, but you know, other questions related to physical properties. And all this, and one thing which I find very interesting is that we believe that we are studying this problem, that this scenario also extends to the case of continuous weights, because in the case of continuous weights, what happens is that domain, the space of solution, which is a continuous space, breaks into an exponential number of small domains, and then this domain may aggregate according to this kind of behavior. So that's the main conjecture. And so these are the conclusion that if you, with the 1RSB scheme, if you look at rare events, you might lose this kind of information either because it's hidden in the paramagnetic solution or for reasons that are not clear to me at the moment. So somehow you have to adapt the tools and try to look at rare events. So how general this is, I have no idea. It could be that we have not yet studied a finite connected problem like KSAT or other problems like this, but this is certainly something we want to do. And it's clear that this notion of having high density region, it's a way of defining accessible regions, you know, because you have a lot of solutions. It's clear that if you have a region with a lot of solution, this should be accessible for stochastic process, which, however, should not satisfy detailed balance, because if they would get trapped in the Gibbs measure. So somehow they are accessible, but not for detailed balance dynamics. And also we are very much interested in computational neuroscience questions which are related to, you know, to how to use this in, you know, neuromorphic devices and also for learning problems and so on. But this is our very, so the message for this workshop is, well, you know, there's a large deviation measure which is very powerful from the algorithmic point of view. There's a lot of work to do, and maybe this generalizes to other cases, and it could be interesting to think about it. Okay. So,
yeah. Questions? When you do the Simoetian in, so you are at a higher energy.
Which one? The replicated one or the standard one?
No, the standard one. The one where you put the weight proportional to the entropy, the local entropy.
Ah, yeah.
Okay, so you want to put this extra weight with the local entropy, but since you are in a configuration which is non-zero energy, are you looking around you for other configuration of that same energy, or you are counting solution around you, but you are not a solution? So.
Oh, you don't care. You don't need to be a solution, if that is the question. You don't have to put the constraints that the reference vector is itself a solution. You forget about that. You just try to maximize the density of solution around you. Then you can compute analytic. I didn't show this is a byproduct of the calculation. The chance that you are a solution is actually very, very high. So at the end of the day, you don't need to impose that constraint. So you just look at solution around you, and that's it. You don't care about the reference vector being a solution.
And you approximate that entropy by dB?
Well, that's one way of doing it. And another way of doing it is by doing the replicated version. And
but again, in the replicated, the Y replicas, none of them has zero energy, because we are still in the initial part of the simulated annealing.
Yes.
So it's counterintuitive that you have Y, say, three replicas, none of zero energy, and you are able to count around you how many configurations there are of zero.
Well, but this is it comes out from calculation. Huh? You take Y integer and you get this replicated. I understand your point. It's counterintuitive, but that's let's say.
How big is D in the calculation?
Sorry?
How big is D in the calculation?
D, D is of order N. So typically, but I mean, you okay, one thing that you do is that you reduce D along your simulation so that you get more and more confined. At the beginning you get it large and then you reduce D. Actually, we use the conjugate parameter to the overlap, so it's, but that's the main message.
Yeah. Is there a dual approach where, I mean, it's sort of what people often do in practice where you just, you have an under-constraint problem and it's sort of hard, you can take the examples, just perturb them a little bit. Mm-hmm. So each example you perturb, you know, distance, Hamming distance delta, you take many copies, and then you do the, solve the optimization problem. Are you expecting to see the same kind of smoothing?
Maybe. I don't, there are many, I should say that, for instance, we didn't think about, for instance, there should be a straightforward generalization to linear programming also, but didn't have time to do that. And also there is a paper by a group of Jan LeCun, who, and what they're doing is they call it elastic gradient. So essentially they do the same thing in the continuous limit. They just, what their argument is just say it's better to have more samplers, just one. That's the idea. And they can show that for deep networks, it's actually working very well. So this is another argument, I think, in favor of the fact that in the case of deep network, essentially one conjecture is that the landscape could be such that there exists this local dense region which have good generalization properties and are accessible.
Yeah.
Your modification of the Gibbs measure created solutions which have a very good learning property but very poor storage property because you lost the basin of the production.
But storage, okay, I see. But storage, I think that probably what you mean by storage, you are thinking about an attractor network that needs to remain confined. No, but this, here's different. There's no dynamics here. You give an input, it's enough that the output is correct. So it doesn't need to be attractive. So even if it is, even if it doesn't have a gap, it could still have good storage properties.
But it's not good error correcting.
No, it's not a good error correcting, no.
So can you take other systems which are error correctors and do something similar to create?
Maybe. I don't think that if you use parity check, I guess this would not help very much because parity check are, by construction, you know, kind of isolated. But so I think this is a, I'm sure there are other systems for which all these properties hold, but I wouldn't look for parity checks, I would rather look for you know, kind of an interpolation between parity and sum. I don't know exactly, but I wouldn't think that in the case of parity check this would lead to anything new because they are really have point like things. So
let's thank Ricardo.